Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please? Welcome to the stage, Donna Dolman, Senior Vice President, Operations and Communications, Ann Arbor SPARK.
Good afternoon and welcome to SPARK's third annual meeting. I see so many in this room by your mere presence that are so passionate about economic development in this region. And we are grateful. We are grateful for you here today, because you all play a part in helping SPARK deliver real, meaningful results. And this room actually is meaningful to me, because it was a room up until 2007 I often ate lunch in during my time at Pfizer. And we know a lot has changed since that time. One of the things that hasn't changed is SPARK's commitment to helping businesses and talent with the tools they need to grow. And I have my own example of that. When Pfizer closed, SPARK offered a starting your own business workshop, and I attended. It compelled me to stay here and start my own business, my marketing consulting company, instead of relocating to New York. So from helping businesses with their marketing strategy to where I stand today, marketing and promoting the Ann Arbor region to the globe, SPARK has made an impact on me positively. And we all have those stories about why we chose to work and live in this great region. These are the stories that reflect SPARK's true work. They inspire the SPARK team every day to continue to work our mission every single day. And of course, we're also inspired by our leader, Paul Krutko. Paul has had a great journey on this road to Ann Arbor and brings over 35 years of experience to economic development. There is no doubt that this expertise has had a tremendous impact on our success, and you'll hear more about that today. Please join me now in welcoming Paul Krutko.
I started when I was five. Thank you, Donna. It's a real pleasure to host the third annual meeting today. We had sort of a vision that we wanted to create this kind of community event, and we've been building towards this over the last 3 years. And I want to go off script here a little bit and congratulate Donna. She's done a fabulous job in pulling this event together. So thank you, Donna. Today's event wouldn't be possible without the generous support of all of our sponsors. I want to especially thank them. Our annual meeting premier sponsor is Comcast Business. We want to make sure that you enter your business card. They have a little drawing at the end for something good. I don't know what it is, but it's going to be something good. And we would like to thank our other sponsors, McKinley, the Bank of Ann Arbor, PNC Bank, Business Leaders of Michigan. Thank you, Doug. Russell Video, the Ann Arbor Area Community Foundation, the Convention and Visitors Bureau, thank you, Mary, and also the University of Michigan Credit Union and Wagner Design. So please join me in thanking them for their sponsorship. Doug Rothwell, President and CEO of Business Leaders of Michigan, is here today, and we're looking forward to hearing from him a little later after lunch. We're also very excited to have Nigel Francis, Senior Automotive Advisor to the State of Michigan, here. I'm looking forward to hearing from both of them. This is SPARK's ninth year, and I can say that it's a great day in the Ann Arbor region. I see entrepreneurs in this room, innovators, elected officials, and business leaders who've been part of this community for years, and were here at the beginning, many of you, in creating SPARK. I see educators and executives all doing important work in the nonprofit sector. The strength of our economy lies in this diversity and the fact that we are working together as partners, both on the public, private, and academic side, to make and create economic prosperity in this region. And your shared commitment to this mission is really what's making a difference. So we've had a lot of folks come in late, so I do want to ask all the elected officials that are here if they could stand and be acknowledged I know Chris Taylor's here. I think Yusuf Robbie's here. Sally Peterson. Carol Griffith. Spalding Clark. And we thank you for your service. I also want to acknowledge our board and executive chairman, Tim Marshall, and the rest of our executive committee and all the committees. Those of you that are involved in SPARK at the committee level, could you all stand and be recognized? I am blessed to lead one of the finest professional economic development staffs in the country. And I don't speak of that from just as a boss talking about his team. I've had the honor of chairing the International Economic Development Council, which is the professional organization of economic developers all over the United States. And all of my colleagues wish that they had a team like we've been able to assemble in SPARK. Could I have the SPARK staff please stand and be acknowledged? In 2013, SPARK marketed this region, met with growing businesses, and provided important resources to startups. Our results in 2013 resulted in a banner year. $148 million in new investments in our region, and 1,509 jobs were committed by those companies as a part of those investments. Pretty impressive for a community this size. 125 startups were assisted, and 83 new companies were incubated in our accelerator facilities. Business attraction and retention resulted in 45 successful projects. The important news, though, I think for all of you in this room who are a part of making this economy work in our region, is that we've gotten all of the jobs back we lost in the Great Recession here in the Ann Arbor region. We have an unemployment rate that is 3% less than the state as a whole, and 1.5% less than the nation. And we have had year-over-year GDP growth of 3% since 2008, far exceeding the nation as a whole. The details of this work and the stories of the companies that are growing in the region are in your annual report. A copy is at your seat. I would really encourage you to look at those stories. They're very inspiring about what's happening both with mature companies and early stage companies. Over the last year, SPARK has worked in collaboration with the City of Ann Arbor and the Ann Arbor Chamber of Commerce to bring a new valuable resource to the region, the Virtual Business Advisor, and I think there was a demo that you might have seen. This exciting new tool will help business owners assess their needs and deliver to them online tools and training to meet their needs. Our goal is to help not only the very largest companies in our community create jobs, but if we think if the smaller businesses can add one job at a time, we can have a dramatic impact as well in that sector. Looking forward, you're going to hear a lot about this from Nigel. We're also excited about the potential created by autonomous and connected vehicles. This sector truly is the marriage of our automotive heritage and our high-tech future. There's no better place. I've learned this from Nigel. He's done the research. He has the data. There's no better place in the world for this technology to evolve, but it is ours to lose. And so SPARK is focused on and committed to advocating for Ann Arbor to be the worldwide center of vehicle innovation. We have key partners in this room in terms of Toyota in their center here, as well as Hyundai, Kia, and many others, but we need to do more. I recently presented our story along with J.R. Ricalta to the Silicon Valley Auto Tech Council. They are companies that want to get into this space, and we made the case that they need to do their work here. We're hoping and working very hard with Walbridge to transform the Willow Run plant into a center where this innovation can thrive, building on the recent announcement that the university made for a similar but smaller facility to get this effort going. And we continue to connect with researchers, engineers, and manufacturers to give them the resources they need right here in this region. As we think ahead to the work that SPARK is committed to doing this year, I'm reminded of the leadership that we have here to support that work. Real leadership is rooted in action. It requires time and commitment, and it requires acknowledgement of the importance of collaboration. Albert Berriz is such a leader. He's co-managing member, CEO, board member, and co-owner of McKinley, a real estate investment company that owns and operates a $4.6 billion real estate portfolio with 1,600 full-time staff members, over 35,000 apartment units, and over 21 million square feet of shopping centers and office buildings in 27 states. And he works from Ann Arbor. He's responsible for acquiring and managing these assets in excess of $7 billion during his career. If anybody understands how the economy works, it's Albert. More than just contributing to the economic success of this region, Albert is a tireless advocate for business in this region. And I want to add to this, a tireless advocate for Spark. He understands that when any one business succeeds, the ripple effect can be powerful. And in his role as chairman of Spark's Development Committee, Albert gives his time, energy, and vision to helping others understand why Spark. So many don't understand what Spark is and the work that we do. Albert is a champion for the impact of growing businesses in our region and the potential created by Ann Arbor being known as a thriving area of innovation. Please join me in welcoming Albert Berriz to the stage.
Afternoon. I think that we have, having over 250 people here today, is a testament to Paul and his team and the terrific work that Ann Arbor Spark is doing. As I always remind Paul, that we do three things at Ann Arbor Spark: jobs, GDP, and creating organizations that pay property taxes. Because you can't have schools, you can't have roads, you can't have parks without property taxes. We operate in 34 states nationwide. At my stage in my career, most of my time is spent working with people like Paul. And I will tell you, I put him in a category of what I consider to be the three best organizations in the country today, and they're unique, and actually, they share a characteristic that's very similar to Ann Arbor. They're all part of research university communities, and they have forged an enormously powerful public-private partnership between those universities, government, and the private side. By the way, those organizations are, if you haven't been, my good friend Doug Rothwell will appreciate my first organization. There is no one like the Cary Riley Research Triangle Park organization, which is Paul's competitor, if you may. They are a force, they're global, they're everywhere in the world, and they epitomize what we would like to be like, and we will be like, quite frankly, as we work harder and harder at it, on the private side, how the private side comes together with world-class institutions, terrific pro-business government, and some enormously powerful funders on the private side as well. The other one is Central Florida, and they are equally powerful in what they do, and they are a force, and it doesn't hurt to have Disney as your main funder, and that helps too. By the way, if you haven't spent time with the people in the organization, these people are extraordinarily good business developers. My job is to develop business. And I will tell you right now that Luke Bonner is as good as anybody that I know at producing deals. He's really that good. And I don't think you could have said, I mean, just what you saw with Donna today, what you saw in Donna speaks for herself. The woman is terrific. I would be very proud to have her go anywhere in this country representing us as a business community, and she will be as eloquent one-to-one as you saw her be in front of 300 people here today. She's extraordinary. Two hard examples of what we're doing that are in the last 30 days, one example, 6 months in the other example. Bruce and Chuck and the team at Toyota are bringing 250, not jobs. These are high-paying jobs. These are very highly paid individuals into this community that don't exist today. And quite frankly, they left a location in California because they were not pro-business, and they felt the tax structure was not as favorable. That's not them saying, that's Albert saying it. That's not Toyota saying that, by the way. And they went to, by the way, just so you know, Texas and Ann Arbor, Michigan. That should tell you something about what we're doing here with Ann Arbor Spark. And I know for a fact that front and center, they would both say to you that Paul and his team were cornerstone to bringing those 250 jobs, cornerstone to supporting them. By the way, thank God for Toyota. And let me tell you what an amazing organization to have in this business community. What an amazing partner to have. Obviously, in addition to that, we get world-class executives. And it's just extraordinary. The other one I will tell you right now, he just walked in the room, is J.R. Ricolta and his father, John. By the way, it is not Walbridge, the construction company, which I think you probably know is top five global construction companies in the world today. And their clients are BMW, Toyota, Ford. They are building every single major plant anywhere in the world, and certainly in the United States. So if you don't know, and I won't embarrass them, but all of the money that's going into Willow Run is his father's money and his money. It's family money. It's not the company's money. And so it's the Ricolta family money going in there. For the Ricoltas to come into Ann Arbor, these people are not good. They're extraordinarily good business people. We should support them. We took a plant that was operating that went dark, and now they're putting their own money into revitalizing that. We're the largest owner of property in Washtenaw County, which by default makes us the largest taxpayer in Washtenaw County. It's not easy to discern. You'd have to aggregate all the entities that we own, and then you have to put it all together. For those of us that work hard on the eastern side of the county, when that plant shut down, the incident of crime and the impact it had on the school districts on that side of the county was palpable. It was palpable. And for JR and his father, John, to come back into this county now and spend, not a little bit, by the way, because I know the amount, a lot of their own personal money to do this is terrific. And I will tell you, if you ask JR after this meeting today, the single biggest supporter of his efforts has been Luke Bonner and Arbor SPARK. So join me now watching this beautiful video about what all the great work that we're doing at Ann Arbor SPARK, and I'll come back to you in just a few minutes after this presentation. Thanks to Donna. This video is all her. She did a terrific job, and I think it shows you all the great work that the organization's doing. It's time for the private side to step up and do their part for Ann Arbor SPARK. The county's been amazing. Yusuf and his organization, his team there have been terrific. The city's been terrific. And the University of Michigan and Washtenaw Community College and Eastern Michigan University have been terrific. We have $1.5 million annual sustainable operating goal to raise from the private side community. We are at $650,000 today. My partner and I made a lead gift of $500,000 over 10 years. We will never raise money from others until we put money up ourselves. And we made that. We made it 10 years because we didn't want to make it 2 years, because we don't need money for a year or two. We need money in perpetuity for this organization. It's absolutely essential. You saw Trevor up here in the video. DTE is our largest private side funder, at $100,000 a year. That is huge. Jerry Anderson and Trevor are at the center of that decision. We're blessed that both of them are here, local, and of course, writing some very large checks. I cannot emphasize enough how important it is that we support this organization. I will close with my personal example that I always like to share, and it's one that I can only share in the last 5 months. I have a 27-year-old son who was a summa cum laude graduate of the Ross School of Business, and he was courted by just about every company in the country, and he chose to move to Chicago. And I said, son, don't you want to stay in the family business? We could hire you. I think there may be an opening. He said, Dad, you know, I love Ann Arbor. I went to school here. By the way, he was Angel Elementary, and he went all the way through here on high school, and he was a graduate of the University of Michigan. So he is pure Ann Arbor, right? He is from you know, our neighborhood, and I know Commissioner Peterson is here. Kay Peterson sold us our house, by the way, in 1988. So that's how long we go back with that organization. But he said, you know, I don't want to live in Ann Arbor because it's not a cool place to live. All my friends want to live in Chicago because it's walkable. Our jobs are there. My friends are there. And while I love having grown up in Ann Arbor, it's not where I want to spend my career. And so November of last year, we came in for Thanksgiving, and we walked around Liberty. We walked around downtown. He said, Dad, I want to live here again. So for an old guy that has kids and grandkids, the work that Ann Arbor SPARK is doing is about keeping those smart young people who are fleeing to because they think California or Chicago or New York is a better place to live. So if I can't put this in terms of jobs and GDP, I'll put it in terms of my son, Andrew Berriz, who is now elected to come back to live in Ann Arbor because the environment that Paul and his team has put together has said it's a cool place to live. With that, if I haven't called you yet, I will be calling you, and I would expect that I will be asking you for money, and thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. We're going to continue on with our program. But please continue to eat. It's my pleasure right now to introduce you to our Vice Chair of our Board and Executive Committee, Cynthia Wilbanks. Cynthia is the university's Vice President for Government Relations, and she directs the university's government relations programs at the local, state, and federal levels, and supervises the activities of the State Outreach Office. Cynthia, we're so fortunate to have your leadership, your talent, and your expertise. Please join me in welcoming Cynthia Wilbanks.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's great to see so many people here in support of our community, in support of SPARK, and certainly in support of a very bright future. It's really my pleasure to be here today, and it's been a real treat to be able to join with SPARK's leadership in leading this organization and in a community that is so important to our state and our local economy. I have the honor of introducing our first speaker this afternoon, and we are joined today by the Business Leaders for Michigan's president, Doug Rothwell. Doug has worked as an executive in the public, private, and nonprofit sectors, and having worked for three state governors. I don't know too many people that have worked for three state governors, but Doug has, and he stands as a survivor. He's also worked for two Fortune 500 companies, General Motors and the Bank of America's credit card subsidiary. In addition to his role at Business Leaders for Michigan, Doug chairs the Michigan Economic Development Corporation Board, and in 2010, after Governor Snyder's election, was named to lead the governor's transition team. I actually remember talking with Doug and his wife Sharon, who were co-leading that team. I don't think they ever left their house for weeks as they were putting together the plans to help the governor launch his time in office. So thank you for doing that work. He's also on the Board of Visitors for the University of North Carolina. You can often see Doug in Carolina Blue. And serves on the U.S. Council of Competitiveness Organizations Board. In a few minutes, he will talk about the updated 2014 Michigan Turnaround Plan that was released a little earlier this month. And I hope many of you have an opportunity to see something about the plan. You'll hear a lot more about it today, but Doug and his team have really done a great deal of work to expose the state of Michigan's citizens to what their plan calls for. Advertising on local networks, on radio, it's really tremendous leadership to provide the citizens of Michigan a vision as to what is possible. But before he comes to the podium, I'd like to tell you just a little bit more about the Business Leaders for Michigan and their work. As you may know, it is a private nonprofit executive leadership organization whose mission is to develop, advance, advocate, and support high-impact strategies that will make Michigan a top 10 state, a top 10 state for jobs, personal income, and a healthy economy. If that sounds familiar, that's exactly what Albert Berriz called for in our community with Ann Arbor SPARK. BLM is made up of the chairpersons, chief executive officers, or most of the senior executives of Michigan's largest companies and universities. Their members drive over 25% of the state's economy, provide over 325,000 direct and 820,000 indirect jobs in Michigan. They generate over $1 trillion in annual revenue and serve nearly one half of all Michigan Public University students. I can say, sitting at the University of Michigan, it has been a tremendous opportunity for the University of Michigan, Michigan State University, and Wayne State University's presidents to be amongst the senior leadership, business leadership, private sector leadership in the state, to help understand the very complex issues that the state confronts and ways in which those two sectors, universities and the private sector, can work together to advance Michigan's economy. We are grateful to the BLM for that opportunity. The work that they have done as BLM members is defined by the Michigan Turnaround Plan, and turnarounds don't happen overnight. And in Michigan's case, we're on a path, but it may take many years. But I think we all see signs that Michigan has turned the corner and has a bright future ahead. So today, Doug is going to provide an update on progress Michigan has made, talk about the new plan, including the very important work that they've been doing in support of higher education, and discuss how you can help build Michigan's future. Please join me in welcoming CEO Doug Rothwell.
How's everybody doing? Good, great lunch, good afternoon. I have to tell you, first of all, I have to brag on people a little bit here. I know that we want to keep time going, but you have one of the classiest individual leaders in all of Michigan, in Cynthia Wilbanks. I've known Cynthia for a long time being in Michigan, and I tell you, she is a delight, absolute delight to work with. Also, I am so proud to call Ann Arbor my home. It's so great to be here with so many people that I've had a chance to work with for so many years, people like Ken Fisher, and Vern is out there somewhere, and I don't know, just I won't name you because I'll be here all day doing that, but this is my hometown, and so I have a lot of passion for the work that you're doing, and one of the things in particular I think that you've done such a great job of is hiring somebody like Paul Krutko to run Ann Arbor SPARK. This organization, I remember when it was first formed by our then governor, our now governor, Rick Snyder, who at that time was the first chair of the organization. And what it's come to over the last decade is really something. And Paul, you brought it up to another whole level. So again, let's congratulate Paul on a great, great job. And the last thing I want to do is, you know, I get really an honor to be up here and represent kind of the top executives of the largest companies in our state. A couple of them have been here today. Albert Berriz was one of my board members. Rick DeVore was here or is still here. Where's Rick? There's Rick. He's way over there. Mary Sue Coleman is, of course, on my board. Patrick Doyle, you know, we got a great Ann Arbor little mafia that's on there kind of making sure you guys are represented, which is good. And, you know, in a day and age when kind of for some reason big business has gotten a bad reputation, I got to tell you, I and the rest of our staff at BLM, we relish it. We are so proud to have our roles because we know that this state wouldn't be where it is today if it weren't for the work of these tremendous business leaders. And so I'm here today to talk to you a little bit about kind of what their vision is of where we are, how we got to where we are, where we're going in the future, and hopefully how you can play a big part in moving us forward. So what I want to start with is stating the obvious. Cynthia talked about kind of what your goals are for Ann Arbor SPARK, and you know, they're kind of our goals too. They're also, though, you must remember the goals of just about everybody in the world. These are not unique goals we have great jobs and great economies and more income. It's what everybody wants, but by, you know, the law of averages is not everybody's going to be able to have those things, okay? And so when you look at Michigan, you know, go back a few years, I mean, we were certainly not on the path to getting there. If you look at some of the standings where we were in different rankings, and certainly on the scorecard that we care most about, we were, you know, we're down near the bottom. The last few years, yeah, things are moving in the right direction. We're certainly a lot better off than we were, but, you know, the absolute rankings of where we are on, you know, incomes and jobs and GDP, I mean, we are still a long way from being, you know, a top 10 state, which is what we think the goal ought to be. I mean, yeah, it'd be terrific to be number one, but top 10 is a realistic goal, at least for us to try to get to. So the question is, how do you get there? And we kind of take the look, as you would expect, you know, a bunch of business leaders that say, look, in the marketplace, when you provide more value for the dollar compared to who you're competing against, you're generally going to win in the marketplace. Well, we think that's kind of true for communities and for states as well. And if you look at kind of where we are, or where we were, at least, going back again to 2009, on most of the metrics that you would want to pay attention to, we were either not top 10 or we were actually getting worse on many of those. If you look today where we are, 2012, 2013, more standards where we're top 10, more that we're actually moving in the right direction, but we're still not, again, where we would like to obviously get to. So let me just give you some highlights. Business tax climate, biggest improvement of any state in the country over the last few years. We actually were the second worst. We're now ninth best because of getting rid of the Michigan business tax, replacing it with a corporate income tax. If you look, for example, at you know, the overall tax burden in the state, we're not top 10, but we're pretty darn close. The only issue that's really holding us back is the personal property tax, and I'll come back to that in a second. However, if you look at the total cost of doing business in Michigan, we're still 40th, and you might say, geez, how could we possibly be still below average with all the, you know, labor contracts that have been revised and property values going down? Well, it's only about 3% more than the average state, but the problem is, for a lot of you folks in small business, you know that 3% is often your profit margin. And so we can't just kind of wash that away and say, well, that doesn't matter, it's only 3%. And I think more than anything, this data point should tell us and be an indicator that our competition, our competitors, didn't stand still during the last decade while we were having our problems either. Now, on the value side of being in Michigan, there's a lot of good reasons to be here. Great state if you're exporting from. We are eighth strongest export state in the country. Great state if you want to innovate because of our research and development base. You know, venture capital used to be the thing that we always used to complain about. You know, there was no capital here in the state. Geez, we went from being 35th, 36th a few years ago to now 19th, one of the fastest growth rates of any state in the country. But let's talk about talent. You look at the technical education level, which you would think would be a real strength for Michigan. We actually only rank 25th in terms of the number of our workforce that have some type of a technical education background, which is getting better, but still not as fast as we'd like. Look at the overall education attainment level of our workforce that has a bachelor's degree or more, and we rank 30th in the country. And the reason why this is a bit of an issue is because more and more of the jobs of the future are going to require that level of education. And by the way, we don't do a very good job of attracting in talent to make up for those that we're not producing here inside the state borders. If you look at the percentage of our kids in the 11th grade that are deemed to be college or career ready, only about 20-some percent of them are meet that standard. And that ranks 37th in the country. And it also, by the way, is 50% below top 10 states. And my guess is most of those kids are getting a high school degree the next year. Okay? So we think we've got a talent problem in Michigan. Infrastructure, yeah, the roads are bad. We know this. Actually, I could probably argue that we maybe are getting good value for money because, you know, we're still one above one of our top 10 states in terms of having quality roads. But there you have it. I mean, the reality is that we're not where we want to be, even though we're getting better. So, yes, the economy's improving. We're hiring again, 250,000 jobs created in just the last year. Incomes are going up, population's even going up. We lost population for a decade. And I think maybe the thing that's improving the most, more than the numbers, are the perceptions that people have about Michigan. You know, these were words that really got in the way in the past in terms of how people felt about this state, a place to invest in, a place to live in. But they're being replaced by different kinds of perceptions that I think are much more positive, more powerful, and really, no matter what the data may say, is really a better indicator in many respects of kind of what our future might hold. We also think that a lot of the progress that's been made is because, as Cynthia talked about, people have been following this Michigan turnaround playbook that we put out back in 2009. If you look at just the sheer volume of actions that have been taken, most of them align pretty well with the first time we put this report out 5 years ago. And it was the work of a lot of people. It wasn't BLM, it was state leaders, the governor, the legislature, community and regional leaders all across the state. But though there's one thing that I wanted to really share with you that if there's nothing else you know, don't leave with today, this is the thought I want you to make sure that you have. And it's this. I ran into a corporate executive who's not on our board a few months back who was feeling pretty good about the fact that Michigan was no longer 50th on all the, you know, the lists. You know, and they said something to me that just, though, got me really riled up and excited, and this was the quote. Average is okay. If there is anybody in this room that honestly believes that being average in today's economy is okay, you can just shut me down right now and not pay attention to another word I'm gonna say, because this is our enemy. This is our enemy. The biggest thing we have to be concerned about right now is complacency. And here's why. Just take a second and read this quote by Thomas Friedman. Only the best places are where business can locate today because they are up against competitors that are doing business around the world and have access to the best places to be. Only the best. Good is not good enough. Average stinks. And that's why it's important that we not get complacent that we're no longer 50th, we're 37th, or whatever the ranking is that I showed you just a few minutes ago. You need to have a plan. You need to have a plan to get there. It can't just be a goal that you set. And what we've tried to do, the role we've tried to fill in the state, is to give you a fact-based strategy or glide path as to how to get there based on benchmarking and best practices and looking at what the global trends are so that we can give ourselves kind of a common way of moving forward, and that's what we call the Michigan Turnaround Plan. Now, this plan has changed quite a bit since we first came out with it. Back in 2009, it really was very focused on business climate improvements because we thought that's what was most needed. Whereas a couple years ago when we updated it, it started to talk a little bit more about leveraging the assets we had in Michigan to accelerate growth, whereas today we've tried to simplify it down to just three simple steps that I'm going to spend the rest of my time talking about, which is what we need to do to compete, to invest, and to grow, to accelerate job growth. So when we talk about competing, we mean making sure that we never stop getting to be a more efficient and effective place to be, investing for growth, and then accelerating the growth of our companies. Competing, let's talk about what that means. Costs, you have to continually make sure that you keep your costs in line with your competitors when you're in a global market. You've got to be able to have a stable fiscal environment with no surprises to both your business and individual customers. You need to make sure that you are a place that's easy to do business in. You need to have the tools in your toolbox to be able to get the job done, and you also need to do it cohesively across jurisdictional lines so that you present one face to your customer in this global world. So when we talk about competing, one way that we can do that is to get rid of taxes that we have or costs that we have that other places don't. And one example of that is the personal property tax. Let me explain what the personal property tax is. It is neither personal nor is it very effective. It's a tax on business that basically says anytime a company decides to invest in themselves or to make work easier for their employees by buying a piece of equipment, by buying a new piece of furniture, we tax them. And in fact, those assets stay on the tax rolls for as long as 40 or 50 years. That is not what other states do. It is not the right message we should be sending when we're trying to actually attract more investment and create more jobs in our state. And it also leads to an unstable source of revenue for local governments who depend on that money to be able to provide things like police and fire services. So you'll have an opportunity this August, it's on the ballot, to vote to get rid of this tax, which will make Michigan, hopefully at that point, a top 10 state for having a great business climate environment. We're building up our rainy day fund. We spent it all in the last decade. We build it up now to about 3% of our operating reserves. We could do better. We should be up around 5%. We're paying down some of our debt. We built up about $60 billion worth of long-term debt over the last decade. Again, we've paid down about a third of it, but we still have two-thirds left to go. We still have to do a better job at shifting our spending priorities. We spend still about 10 times more per person per year to house a prisoner than we do to help a kid go to college. We don't think that's the right set of priorities for Michigan, so the budget is not still where we think it should be. We still do a lot of law passing and law amending and introducing bills that we have absolutely no idea what the cost of those are going to be on government, on business, on you as individuals. And so we think actually a new law ought to be passed. And that law ought to be that there is a price tag that's put on every piece of legislation before it gets to be introduced in the legislature. My guess is you would see far fewer bills passing. Far fewer bills passing, and ones that pass better understood. We think regions are really important to making sure that we have a strong economy, especially in this global age, because you can't, as an individual jurisdiction, sell your assets and be competitive when you're going up against mega regions around the world. Only by working together can you effectively do that. And so it's really important that groups like Ann Arbor SPARK exist to make sure that it's the entire community that's represented, not just one-offs, and that you really need to take a look more and more at local site location factors, not just those that are influenced at the state level. Zoning and permitting, for example, can often be as much of an impediment to attracting jobs as things that the state directly controls. The other thing is that we have a lot of units of local government in Michigan, more than most states, and so it's more important that we share services here across jurisdiction lines than other places. And in particular, we think that it's important to send the message to regions that if you work well together, you ought to have the ability to raise funds to fund your regional assets. So if there are transit systems or park systems that you think ought to be funded regionally, you shouldn't have to go to Lansing to ask their permission to fund those things. You ought to be able to decide that for yourselves. The second area that, again, we think is important as part of this plan, first being competitive, second is to invest, just like a business would if they want to grow. And there are two priorities that we think matter more than any others. One is to invest in your infrastructure, and the other is in your people or your talent. Infrastructure is important because you need to get your people and products to your customers around the world. When you rank last in the country, as we do, investing in our infrastructure, that's not a good place to be. And so there are some that would say that we can fix our roads, for example, by just finding more money in the operating budget in the state, and we don't need to raise taxes. We are here to say that we need to raise taxes, and we need to raise them significantly. At least $1.5 billion a year or more to fix our roads. And by the way, even $1.5 billion, once we do that, that will still not get our roads in the shape that some of the other states we compete with. It's not going to provide the beautiful landscapes and things like that that you see as you drive around the rest of the country. That is just to fix the bare bones infrastructure of the roadbeds themselves. So we think that's a priority, and by the way, it's the beginning of the iceberg, because really, if you look at the other sewer lines, water systems, and the like that we built, most of it was done back in the 50s and 60s, and so we're going to have to step up a lot more to fix our infrastructure in the years ahead. The other is talent, because we know that the more folks get better educated, the more they earn, the less they're able to needing government services, the more they're going to be employed. And we also know by looking at the numbers that you see up here that 60% of the jobs that are going to be created here in the next decade are going to require some level of education beyond high school. Yet today we only have about 30% of our workforce with that level of education, and only about 20% of 11th graders are deemed to be college or career ready. So it gets back to having that talent deficit that we think needs to be made up. The way we look at it is that we need to kind of have a very comprehensive approach to addressing this. One is to make sure that preschool is available widely for kids. The good news is the legislature and the governor are going to support getting that done this year for all income eligible kids. But when kids get in school, there have to be good standards put in place. It's why we're big believers of the Common Core state standards, and those standards have to be tied to tests, so that we can assess not just how our kids are doing between Ann Arbor and Saline, but Ann Arbor and Portland, Oregon, and Seattle, and the other places that we are competing with for jobs and investment. That's hung up right now in the legislature because they're fearful on the far left that it's going to be tied to teacher evaluations or other types of performance-based funding, and they're fearful on the right it's going to lead to nationalized education. So those of us that are hopefully in the middle that care about this, that's another issue we could use your help on. More career counseling, more exposure for kids to co-ops and internships as they're going through school. Let's make sure we've got graduation requirements that actually mean something. I mean, if we've got 80-some percent of our kids that are going to be graduating that are not deemed to be college or career ready in the 11th grade, we think that's a problem and that needs to be fixed. And then when kids actually get out of school, whether it's to college or career, realize that we're going to have to provide a lot more support for lifelong learning for them as they go through their lives. When you look at funding on the K-12 side, we actually think Michigan's a pretty good funder. We rank 14th in the country, but again, you get back to the outcomes, that 37th ranking on college and career readiness. We think the issue here is more an issue of performance and structure than it is funding. And I know that's, again, some people would say, well, money is really the problem. We would say, at least with K-12, it's not the primary problem. In higher education, we think it is. What happened in Michigan is we went from being a top 10 state to a bottom 10 state for college affordability in the last decade. And it has been because of that that tuition now has gone up to the point where kids are leaving with the most debt, in the country, sixth highest tuition rates in America. And we think the way that needs to be fixed is to have this be a higher priority for state spending. So that's the invest side of the agenda. For growing, we think it's all about trying to do a better job at leveraging the assets that Michigan already has. Second, that Detroit is really important. We need to be a more welcoming state to grow our population, and we need to out-innovate our competitors to grow jobs. A couple years ago, we put together an analysis that looked at six assets that we already have in Michigan that we think are really the way to accelerate job growth. And you can see them listed up here on the board. And then we went back this past year and we said, well, it's a nice theory, but you know, what has actually happened on the ground? And what we found is that of those six areas, they were responsible for 40% of the new jobs created in Michigan, and that those jobs were being created faster than the other sectors in our state. And by the way, they also pay about 50% more on average than the average jobs do in Michigan. So the point of all this is that we don't have to go out and bring in new industry sectors to our state. If we simply do more of what we do well that the world needs, we can create a lot of good jobs in Michigan. And we think these six sectors are the areas, the sweet spots, if you will, for us to focus on. And in fact, you're doing some of that at Ann Arbor SPARK right now. We think Detroit matters. Detroit matters because it is the image of Michigan outside our state. It is what people think of, and it is why we think it's important for them to get out of bankruptcy as fast as possible. It is a cloud right now that overshadows the redevelopment that's been going on the last 3 or 4 or 5 years. Redevelopment that is happening across the city, not just because of one or two big ticket investments, which means it's more sustainable. And we are very concerned that if bankruptcy continues, that will be a cloud that other investors may give them pause as to whether they want to continue to fuel that reinvestment down the road. So we're big supporters that the state should make a financial contribution to the restructuring plan that's on the table, and we think that that would be a good thing for everybody in Michigan as well. We need to grow population because business needs to be in growing areas for them to be able to grow their businesses. Michigan, as I've said, up until the last year or so, actually was losing population. We can do this by being a more welcoming state, by bringing in more out-of-state kids. Most of our universities are actually under-enrolled compared to their peers in terms of attracting out-of-state students. We can be a more welcoming state in terms of attracting immigrants here and being welcoming to them when they're here. We can be a more welcoming state by not discriminating against people because of their sexual orientation. These are things that make sense for Michigan for the future. We need to be a state that has a better cultural understanding of the people that we actually do business with and want to do business with. This is a map that shows where our largest trading partners are, and they're not all in North America. They're all around the world. And the more that we can have people on our staffs and our companies and our businesses and our universities that have that understanding, the more that folks in those nations are going to feel comfortable dealing with us and trading with us, which will help us grow our businesses and create jobs. We need to out-innovate the competition because that's really how you create the best jobs. And there's several ways you can do that. Some communities have laws on the books that, for example, prohibit your ability to have a business at home. Well, you know, in today's world with entrepreneurship, a lot of businesses need to be created in homes. And so why would we have laws on the books that do that? May have made sense 20, 50 years ago, but maybe not today. We do a lot to support entrepreneurs around the state, but are we really leveraging the best practices across our state to make sure that every community is doing what is the best that's out there? We're growing venture capital. We need to do more of it. But we also could do more in terms of positioning Michigan as a state of innovation. We've done a terrific job from a travel standpoint positioning us as a tourism destination. The Pure Michigan campaign has been a huge success. But what if we took that same type of approach and also tried to brand Michigan as a state of innovation, using some of the iconic products that are made here, designed here, that nobody knows necessarily are associated with Michigan? What if we tried to look at those six asset areas that I talked about, our engineering talent, our location, our auto industry, and we tried to make sure that for every one of those, if there was any conference or meeting taking place in the world, in those subject areas, we bring those to Michigan to get people exposed to the state, because we know once they get here, they have a better impression once they leave. What if we made sure, as we did when the new Detroit Hub Airport was built, that the first impressions that people have of Michigan are the best they possibly can be? In the one day that airport opened, Michigan went from having a dumpy image to a modern image. Well, do we really create that same first impression when people come in on our highways to our welcome centers? Are those really the best impressions that we could have? Other states are starting to realize that those are also first touch points. Think of that same mentality, the first touch points that you have with outsiders, no matter where it is, convention centers, taxis. Are they the right impressions that you want people to have? So this is the playbook that we have. We think it's all about not taking our foot off the pedal in terms of still competing, making sure we have a great business climate, prioritizing on infrastructure and talent to invest to win, and making sure that we can out-innovate our competitors through aggressive growth strategies. We got here because we were in the doldrums 5 years ago, and we knew we had to do something different. And everybody pulled together in this state, across party lines, across regions, all the divisions that stood in Michigan's way in the past, we broke them down, and it's why we got off being 50th up to where we are today. But there is still more work to be done. If you're a parent, you're a voter, here are some things that you can do right now. Call your legislators up. You don't think it matters? I can tell you it does. 10 calls to a legislator's office is it's the world's coming to an end. So if 10 of you would go out and make a call right now to say, raise taxes to fix the roads, I'm telling you, it would be a huge positive step. Get rid of the personal property tax in August. Encourage your kids to go get an education that goes beyond high school. If you're with a civic group, get behind regional strategies. Don't just let one jurisdiction drive what your priorities are. Business, tie your investments to things that really matter across your whole region. Again, to leverage what you're putting into the community. And local officials, a lot of it's about keeping up the work on making sure you keep your financial house in order, because we know when that doesn't happen, really bad things begin to occur. So again, what I want to leave you with is this. Yes, we've made progress. We cannot afford to get complacent. Every other place out there that Paul and his team are going up against right now is coming to want to kick our butts. We've got assets, we've got resources, we've got an auto industry that Nigel's going to talk about that they want. And it is up to all of us to make sure we stay as fired up for the next 5 years as we've been the last 5 years to make the progress that we have. Thanks very much, and I hope you have a great rest of your day. Thank you.
Doug, thank you very much. Thanks for your leadership and all the careful planning that's gone into developing such a strong roadmap for Michigan's future. We're going to move right on into the program with the Chairman's Awards, presented by Tim Marshall. Tim Marshall is the chair of our board of directors and CEO and president of Bank of Ann Arbor, a locally owned and operated full-service community bank with 7 locations in the region. In addition to supporting the lending and deposit needs of our local businesses and consumers, Bank of Ann Arbor is very active in the entrepreneurial community and has built one of the premier technology and life science banking groups in the Midwest. Bank of Ann Arbor is a founding member of SPARK and has been a significant funder and supporter of SPARK since inception in 2005. Thank you, Tim, for your leadership and time and energy you've devoted to SPARK. Please welcome Tim Marshall.
Thank you, Donna. I do have one suggestion for 2015. Cheryl Elliott appropriately pointed out that the color of the ribbons did not match my attire today. So maybe next year we can do a little ribbon sourcing. As chair of the Ann Arbor SPARK Board of Directors, I have the privilege of working with the board, committees, and staff on making amazing things happen in this region. And believe me, amazing things are happening, as we all saw from the earlier video and from the remarks of Albert, Doug, and others. Having been involved in SPARK since its inception, I've seen over the last 8 years the terrific results. SPARK has assisted more than 500 startups, and companies served by SPARK have committed in excess of $1.5 billion in new investments in this region and added 13,000 jobs. And as impressive a track record as that is, it's simply an inspiration for what we can achieve next. To ensure continued success, the board and executive committee developed and launched a 5-year strategic plan for the organization in 2013. This plan sets a framework for long-term vitality and is focused on three key areas of the greatest opportunity for this region: acceleration, talent, and growth. Today, I'm here to present the Chairman Awards in recognition of those individuals and companies that had tremendous impact on our economy last year. These companies and individuals are the models of acceleration, talent, and growth. The first Chairman's Award goes to our 2013 Volunteer of the Year, Ken Nisbet. This award recognizes an individual that has passion for economic development and growing the local economy and companies. Someone who has contributed greatly to our organization on a number of committees and participates in events focused on supporting growing companies. Ken's commitment is indisputable. As executive director of the University of Michigan's Office of Tech Transfer, he has strategic and operational responsibilities for all technology transfer activities at the university. Under his leadership, the university has achieved substantial growth in tech transfer growth, performance, and has established a reputation as one of the leading tech transfer offices in the country. In 2013 alone, U of M researchers submitted a record number of new innovations, 421, and achieved 108 agreements with existing and new businesses. These innovators are the job creators of tomorrow, and we're grateful for Ken and for all the great work that you do to help support this local economy. Please join me in congratulating Ken Nisbet on being our Volunteer of the Year. Thanks, Ken. Congratulations. Our next award, the Entrepreneurial Company of the Year, goes to a company that has utilized SPARK's extensive entrepreneurial services to grow from startup stage to an established and growing company. Listen closely. This is what SPARK does. This is our mission. Company that has made significant progress, achieved acquisition or large venture investment, and created jobs in the region. This year, we honor Tangent Medical Technologies, a company that SPARK first touched through its boot camp in 2009, helping this startup refine its pitch and prepare for fundraising. Tangent was awarded a $250,000 funding award from the Michigan Pre-Seed Capital Fund, which SPARK administered, as well as $10,000 in grants from Ann Arbor SPARK's Business Accelerator. It's continued to work with our business development team as it grows right here in this region. Tangent Medical Technologies is a medical device company commercializing a new class of intravenous fluid delivery catheters. Its NovaCath integrated catheter system is establishing a new standard in catheter design, functionality, and performance. In recent years, Tangent received FDA approval for NovaCath, closed on $8.6 million in new funding from the venture capital community, and was awarded a patent that covers a range of incorporated technologies. It recently began accepting commercial orders for Novacath. Startup, funding, commercial orders. Let's welcome the president of Tangent, Eric Sandberg, Entrepreneurial Company of the Year. The last award that we will recognize today, and then move on to our final speaker. Our final award is for the Business Development Project of the Year, honoring a business development project that is having a significant impact on the local economy, a company that has moved the needle in terms of significant capital investment, the addition or retention of significant jobs, and that has strong potential for continued growth. Our winner is Lake Trust Credit Union. Lake Trust Credit Union announced in 2013 plans to build a new $30 million headquarters on approximately 17 acres adjoining US 23, just north of I-96 near Brighton. Lake Trust is also committing to expand, is committed to expanding the credit union's retail network throughout Michigan, including both Lansing and Plymouth. Lake Trust plans to invest a total of $40 million in Michigan over the next 5 years. Please join me in welcoming David Snodgrass, Lake Trust President and CEO, to the stage. Congratulations. Let's offer a round of congratulations one more time to our three winners.
Okay, we're going to hear from our final speaker. And I'd like to bring Luke Bonner to the stage to introduce our speaker. We've heard a lot about Luke already. Luke is our Vice President of Business Development and leads our business growth and attraction services in both Washtenaw and Livingston counties. Luke has led the visioning of the Willow Run GM powertrain facility as a connected and autonomous vehicle product development center. His day-to-day work gives him tremendous insight on how critical the automotive technology is to our region. My colleague and friend, Luke Bonner.
Good afternoon. Thank you to Doug and Albert for such motivational commentary this afternoon. And also congratulations to our chairman's award winners. It's my pleasure to introduce to you Nigel Francis. Nigel is senior automotive advisor to Governor Snyder and senior vice president of the MEDC's automotive office. Nigel has been charged with developing and executing a comprehensive strategic plan and roadmap to promote our state's most precious asset, the auto industry. Nigel comes to state government with 29 years of executive experience in the global automotive sector, encompassing both technical and technology management in North America, Europe, and Asia. Nigel has held executive level positions at OEM and Tier 1 companies, including Chief Engineering and Program Management for Tata Technologies, COO and Chief Technology Officer at Trexa LLC, Executive Vice President at Bright Automotive, and Vice President of Vehicle Engineering at Mercedes-Benz Technology. Ever since Nigel was announced for his new position, he's been the most sought-after person at MEDC and one of the toughest people to get a meeting with. So we certainly appreciate your time here today. Join me in welcoming Nigel Francis.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm mindful of the time, and I believe we're meant to leave at 1:30, so We're in a wonderful world of virtual reality. The presentation that I'm going to give is actually available through Ann Arbor SPARK, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to get through it and just make some key points. I'd encourage you all to look at the presentation in your own time. It's good bedtime reading, because if you're in the automotive industry, it will be telling you things that you maybe already know to some extent. If you're not in the automotive industry, it's a bit of an eye-opener in some respects. It's very humbling for me as an engineer, actually. I'm an engineer. I'm not a politician by any means. Very, very humbling for me to be here. I guess I'm on hallowed ground, standing at the University of Michigan. And I'm very mindful of the fact that every time I drive to Ann Arbor, because I live in Clarkston, I feel as though I'm driving to the brain trust of the civilized world. And there were some very important points that were brought out earlier, which I'd like to reinforce before I kill you with PowerPoint. You know, we talk about Detroit. I mean, Ann Arbor's got its stuff together. And notice I said stuff together. Detroit is going through a process of putting its stuff together. And those actions are critical for the state of the future, because the young people of the future, the great minds of the future, will want to predominantly live in urban areas and in cities, vibrant cities. And if we don't get it right, we won't have the brains in the state of Michigan that we will need to transport us from our current position to a top 10 state, and after that we'll be going for the pole position, as Mr. Rothwell will be explaining to you in a couple more years, I think, when we get to the 10. I believe that the community here in Ann Arbor has got in its hands the future, a lot of the future of the state of Michigan. I think it's in safe hands, but it's going to need everybody working together to actually spread the news and spread the knowledge, skills, and experience to actually create the state of Michigan that we want to live in. I'd also say that, I'm an immigrant, and it's interesting that, we have an immigration policy that's going on at the moment. I spent 10 years of my life coming here every month and got to love the place. I then moved here to live 16 years ago. I haven't been on vacation outside of the state of Michigan in the last 10 or 11 years, because I don't need to. Everything I need professionally and personally is in the state of Michigan. It's a wonderful place, and we are so lucky. I am so lucky to have found it, or it found me, and I think we are so lucky to live here. So, what I want to do is tell you a few things about what we're doing at the state in relation to the automotive industry, and I think you get this. This information is now available online, and excuse me, I've made a number of presentations all over the world, in fact, to spread the good word. Let's just back up a little bit, and we talked about this a little earlier. You know, 6 or 7 years ago, Detroit and Michigan, and by the way, Detroit and Michigan are synonymous to most of the rest of the world. They're not to us, because we live here. But if you get outside of even the USA, Detroit and Michigan mean the same thing, although they're not. 6 or 7 years ago, every headline in every newspaper, every TV news channel had Detroit Automotive and Michigan all over it, and things were not good. You know, now we've had this monumental turnaround in the automotive industry in the state of Michigan, and a monumental turnaround in the state, which is a work in progress. Nobody's talking about it apart from the select few that actually see it. And what we learn from that is that bad news is news, and good news is something that you need to work on very, very hard. So my one takeaway, my one wish and takeaway for everybody from this discussion here is that you go and tell everybody about how great the automotive industry is in the state of Michigan, how great the state of Michigan is, and what a work in progress that is going on here. It's monumental in global terms what has happened in terms of turnaround in our state, right in our backyard. As you know, the governor's a business guy. I come from industry, and I'm effectively running a startup within a corporation. That's the way I look at it. It's a startup company, the automotive office. So we created a vision and a mission, and we've then gone on and developed a strategic plan which looks out 30 years. That's this document that you can see here, and it's actually online and available for you to look at. I'm going to skip a few slides in a minute because you can look at them later, but why would we want to do this? Well, Michigan's number one industry is the automotive industry. That automotive industry is number one for vehicle production, number one for parts production, number one for powertrain production, number one for patents. Did we hear about that earlier? Innovation, patents. Number one for automotive R&D centers. There's now 375 R&D centers for automotive in the state of Michigan. That's more than anywhere else. It's the greatest density anywhere in the world. That is the brain trust of the industry called automotive. And we talk a lot about cell phones and smartphones. Let me tell you that the modern motor car is many orders of magnitude more complex than any smartphone on the planet. It's ours. We've created that. We're the brains behind it, and we're the women and men behind it that actually create that product and roll that product out for the rest of the world, and it's the envy of the rest of the world. We should be so proud of that. But we need to keep on task. As we heard earlier, and indeed the governor uses the term relentless positive action. You know, complacency is not a good thing. Average is not a good thing. We need to strive to be best and maintain that position as best. In our planning, what we did was we actually decided to look forward 30 years, and that's because we feel very strongly that we need to be ahead of the curve. Anybody that's run a company knows that playing catch-up is not a pleasant thing. But if you can truly innovate, if you can truly predict, if you can truly create value ahead of the market, you're in a great position, because that wave of energy from the market will actually propel you forward. That is what we're about doing in the state of Michigan in the automotive office. What we're working on is ensuring that we have the correct foundational elements in the state to propel us forward. So there's now some slides here which I'm not going to speak to, other than to say that when you look at this presentation, there's talk about how we studied the global megatrends and what it means and how we got to our conclusions. And I think in the time available, it's better to just talk about the conclusions. I have to say that as I'm going over the connected, automated and autonomous vehicle slide on the left of this slide here, I'm very mindful of the fact that the University of Michigan and the University of Michigan Transportation Research Institute are fundamental on a global basis in that area, and that will drive us and our industry forward over many decades, I'm sure. Supply chain, on the right of this slide, supply chain and logistics. We have a fantastic supply chain and logistics system right now. But we need to be sure to keep ourselves as the leader in that on a global basis. The competition is global. We need to be sure that we keep our supply chain and logistics, which means infrastructure, which costs money. We need to keep it in good shape and in globally best in class. So where did we end up? We ended up with identifying three foundational elements that we believe are absolutely critical for the state to remain in the pole position in the automotive industry on a global basis, and to enable and empower the economic growth of the state going forward over many decades. And those three elements are that we need to have the right technologies in place at the right time, with the right talent behind those technologies, and the capital to realize those innovations and those creations going forward. Isn't that about what Ann Arbor SPARK is all about and what this meeting is all about? Isn't this about the message that you've heard from the other speakers? It's very interesting sitting here listening to the other speakers and reflecting on the meeting here today. This meeting to me is about joining the dots. I think we can all join the dots in our minds and actually walk out of here and firstly, we should slap ourselves on the back and say, good job, because everybody's doing such a great job. Secondly, what we should do is forget about that before we get back to our transport and say, but we've got to do better tomorrow, and the day after we've got to do better. But But congratulate yourselves on doing such a great job here in Ann Arbor, and also helping the rest of the state to position itself and grow. At the Automotive Office, what we're doing is we're actually working now towards an operating plan, and I'm in close contact with a lot of economic development colleagues throughout the state, many of which are actually in the room here. And the cartwheel that you see on the right there has got the seven initiatives that we're actually building an operating plan behind. Again, that will be worth reflecting on, and I would say watch this space for more announcements as we go forward week by week and month by month. So, as I said before, there's been a lot of engagement and presentations, which is actually good because it actually gets the word out. It's about promotion, marketing and branding. So yes, I've done a lot of speaking all over the world as it happens. It's humbling for me to do that, but I do it, and I will continue to do it because I'm on a mission. I'm on a mission personally and professionally. From a professional point of view, I come from automotive. It's given me a fantastic living for 30 years of my life, and every single day of my career I've enjoyed what I've been doing. Every single day. And I am so glad that a high school teacher, when I was 16, took me to one side and said, "You need to be an engineer, Francis, because you're good with your hands and you're good with math and physics." And man, was he so insightful. And I remember his name even now. His name was Mr. Lee. Great job. So we promote, and we've all got to promote, but it's not good enough for me to do that. It's not good enough for my staff to do that. We've all got to do it. Please go promote the industry and promote the state of Michigan and what is happening here. This gives you an idea of where we've been. Actually, it's been updated because I've been back to China again. Interesting visit to China. I was on the ground for something like 56 hours, met with three CEOs of the top five Chinese car companies, and interestingly seem to have managed to get 83 media events in as well. So there wasn't a lot of sleeping going on. I also avoided eating chicken heads and chicken feet, so that was good. So we're also doing some things which we're going to be able to roll out at some stage here in the future. I've lost count of the number of times where I've been told there's a talent gap, and then I say, hey, be specific, and nobody can really be specific. And as you heard earlier, I love data, because when somebody comes to me and says, I'm showing you something, I say, well, show me the data. You know, I want to be doing things based on data. So we've actually put a study onto the Center for Automotive Research, another great organization here in Ann Arbor. We are so lucky to have them here. And they will be looking out into the future and actually quantifying what we mean by that talent gap. Then, in my opinion, and this is just my opinion, we won't be playing pin the tail on the donkey. We'll be educating the correct product out of our complete education system. For the needs of our great industry going forward in the right quantities at the right time. And I really believe that that's a proactive measure that we need to take to ensure that we're on a successful track. There's a study that we've actually got close to finishing, where we've looked at each of the major assets in the state of Michigan and the adjacent states to Michigan, including Ontario. And I guess in a systematic way looked at their relative performance. Why would we do that? So maybe what we can do at the state level is get ahead of the game and actually see that there could be a problem with a major facility, a major employer in automotive, and we can then be proactive and go to that company or companies with a solution to the problem that they might not have completely woken up to, or they might be aware of but are just waiting until they tell us that there's a problem. So really what we're trying to do is we're trying to do what engineers do, which is create solutions. Then finally, there's a tool and die study that's going on. As I said, I think that when we're here in Ann Arbor, we can talk about advanced engineering and advanced technologies. When we're in Kent County or Macomb County, let's pay attention to the great tool and die people that exist in those counties that actually are foundational and empowering the production of the parts that are then assembled into vehicles. and without them in the value chain, vibrantly in the value chain, the whole production system for a motor car breaks down, and of course it's no good, no good for anybody. Yeah. So we need to ensure that the complete extended enterprise is empowered within our strategy. Just moving on to some promotional items here. Actually, in a couple of weeks now, there is a very important conference at the COBA, which is called the Big M. Yes, I know. Everybody's thinking, well, that's where we're sitting right at the moment. But you'll notice that the colour comes from the other great university that's somewhere in the middle of the state, right? So the Big M is a manufacturing convergence conference. Please go and take a look at it, Google it, Bing it, or whatever you do. And you'll find out that it's a convergence of advanced manufacturing technologies and thought leadership related to automotive, aerospace, consumer goods, and medical. So as the automotive guy, have it on record that I mentioned medical whilst in Ann Arbor. Moving back to automotive, so we've then got the management briefing seminars from the Center for Automotive Research at Traverse City in August. Interestingly, this year we've been working together with Center for Automotive Research and some other economic development partners to actually bring in a more international flavor in terms of attendance into that conference. I've been to that conference, I think, 10 or 12 times over the last 14 years, and it strikes me that it's about time we got some real, true global outreach coming into that conference within a truly globalized industry. And then we actually saw this slide at the bottom center earlier, the Intelligent Transportation Systems World Congress, which will be at the COBA Center. Very important conference. I now give you just a tiny little bit of tech speak. There's vehicle-to-vehicle and vehicle-to-infrastructure requirements to create an autonomous vehicle. And we hear most of the time about what vehicle-to-vehicle communications, one vehicle communicating to another. The reality is that to create a seamless and secure autonomous vehicle network of the future, we will need to pay very close attention to both vehicle-to-vehicle and vehicle-to-infrastructure requirements. And vehicle-to-infrastructure is basically, a simple example might be, you are driving your car along the road towards a red traffic light and your car automatically slows down because it knows that the traffic light is red. It also knows that the traffic light will change in three seconds, so maybe it can speed up. But actually, another part of the system is telling you that there's a vehicle that's doing 60 miles an hour going across your path that will run a red light and your vehicle will not go, even though the vehicle-to-infrastructure says go, the vehicle-to-vehicle is saying don't go, and it will override. Richard Wallace from Carl's here, if any of that didn't make sense to you, and he'll explain it to you again. So what I'd say is, and I've got a video that I'd like to show in just a second. It takes 2 minutes. I'd really ask you to be patient with that. It looks like I've nearly caught up here. I like to reflect on, you know, what we're doing at the state, and what strikes me as a very obvious, but to me, but maybe not obvious to everybody else. I don't control anything. I have influence over a lot of things. Should the people in the stakeholder group wish to play. So this to me is about very large scale collaboration. And what I'd say is that we really want academia, industry, and government to work together seamlessly within the state of Michigan. If we can do that, we are so strong when we go to the federal government and say, hey, we're doing something sexy over here, nobody else is doing it, give us some money. Because the federal government's got a lot more money than us. And the more we can do of that, we bring that money back into Michigan. That money creates jobs. Those jobs create innovation. Those innovations create companies and products. And it's a circular argument that basically both sustains our economy and grows it for the future of ourselves, our children, our grandchildren. Critically important. What I see is I see the Ann Arbor SPARK, I see the region of Ann Arbor, the great organizations, BLM, etc., here within the Ann Arbor and the Ann Arbor region as being on their game, but it's relentless positive action. Great job today. What have you done for me recently? Okay. So please show the video.
Thank you, Nigel, for sharing your strategy and your vision for this important sector to not only our region, but to our entire state. Thank you for being here. Before we close, I'd like to invite our premier sponsor to the stage for their raffle drawing.
Hi, I'm Todd England with Comcast Business. We are proud once again to support the annual meeting and the mission of Ann Arbor SPARK. Paul, we are always excited to work with your organization, and we actually honor the chance to get that call and make sure that we're one of the people that you count on for this. As a technology company, our missions are aligned to help take innovative companies to the next level, and as you heard today, they are successfully accomplishing their objectives, and we want to support them even further. As you saw from our booth, we had a couple prizes, and we wanted to raffle those off. Actually, a unique event. It's a VIP breakfast with a speech by David Brandon at the University of Michigan and a tour of the athletic facilities. And also during the same week, there's two tickets to the Comcast Suite at Comerica Park for the Tigers-Blue Jays game on Tuesday, June 3rd. So at this time, Donna, if you could pick that winning ticket. Very good, one prize. The winner is Katie Jones with A2Y Chamber. Very good, Katie, can you come on up?
Congratulations, Katie. We hope you leave here energized for the future of the Ann Arbor region and committed to working with those around you at your tables to continue to drive our economy forward. Thank you again for joining us today, and see you next year for our 10-year celebration.
Shining star for you to see what your life can truly be. Shining star for you to see what your life can truly be.